If you serve or have served in a branch of our military, would you please stand and let us recognize you? We are so grateful for your service. So thankful. Thank you so much. Amen. Well, good morning. Welcome to First Church this morning. It's so good to be in the house of the Lord. I will never, ever take that saying for granted ever again. I think that this year has been a year of finding our faith, finding our trust, and being thankful. So this morning, we are going to praise Him. If you're a guest in our midst this morning, know that we feel so blessed to have you with us this morning. And we're just going to get into a world of worship, okay, in a pattern of worship. So if you would stand on your feet and worship with us this morning. Living in a world of turmoil right now. And I know there are a lot of hurting hearts. We want to reach out to Steve. Found out this morning that his mother passed away on Friday, so we keep you and your family in our prayers. We love you, Steve. So if you would bow your heads with me for just a moment. Oh, Heavenly Father, as we stand in this place and we lift our hands and we lift our hearts, some are almost too heavy to lift. Lord, this morning as you reach down to your children, will you please just give us the peace that only comes from you. Lord, we reach our hands to heaven and we reach up for the grace and mercy that comes from beautiful, beautiful love. And Lord, this morning will you be with those in our congregation that hearts are hurting, that hearts are reaching. Heal bodies, heal hearts, and give minds peace. Lord, this morning we lift up Steve and his family. They're going through a deep valley in the shadow of death. And Lord, we want to reach out our hands and offer our love. But we know that the peace that comes from you is so needed. And Lord, be with our world and be with our leaders. Give our world peace. And Lord, we'll ask all these things and be grateful and humble in that beautiful and precious name. In the name of Christ our Savior. Amen.
Shout out your name. Jesus is coming. Good morning. I'm so thankful that we have a worship team, that in our waiting that we can praise him. After this long week, I know it's been a long, long week for most of us. I'm so thankful that I can come on Sundays and praise him in my waiting. The scripture reading today is Matthew 25, 1 through 13. Then the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 bridesmaids who took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. Five of them were foolish and five were wise. The five who were foolish didn't take enough olive oil for their lamps, but the other five who were wise enough to take along extra oil. When the bridegroom was delayed, they all became drowsy and fell asleep. At midnight, they were roused by the shout, "Look, the bridegroom is coming. Come out and meet him." All the bridesmaids got up and prepared their lamps. Then the five foolish ones asked the others, "Please, give us some of your oil, because our lamps are going out." But the others replied, "We don't have enough oil for all of us. Go to a shop and buy some for yourselves." But while they were gone to buy the oil, the bridegroom came. Then those who were ready went in with him to the marriage feast, and the door was locked. Later, when the other five bridesmaids returned, they stood outside calling, "Lord, Lord, open the door for us." But he called back, "Believe me, I do not know you. So you too must keep watch, for you do not know the day or the hour of my return." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Every time I try to make it on my own, every time I try to stand, I start to fall. All those lonely roads that I have traveled on, but that was Jesus. When the life I built came crashing to the ground, when the friends I had were nowhere to be found, I couldn't see it then, but I can see it now, that there was Jesus. In the waiting, in the searching, in the healing, in the hurting, like a blessing buried in the broken pieces. This man who needs amazing kind of grace, for forgiveness at a price I couldn't pay. I'm not made perfect, though I thank God every day that there was Jesus.
There was Jesus.
Oh, in the waiting, in the searching, in the healing. Blessing buried in the broken pieces. Every minute, every moment, where I've been or where I'm going, even when I didn't know it, I couldn't see it. Well, there was Jesus on the mountains, in the valleys.
There was Jesus
in the shadows of the alleys.
Jesus.
No, I'll never walk alone.
Who was
Y'all tear me up. Lord, thank you. Thank you for a church. Thank you for the doors to be open. Thank you for an altar that Miss Bonnie reminded us that we have. And I don't have something, so I'm going to grab this because I can't do like Pastor Brad does and just talk to y'all. Whew, I'd have a nervous breakdown. Okay. Oh, gotta settle down for a minute. That's some good stuff, y'all. Let's just clap for a minute and give God the glory. Oh. I've been all over the place this morning. It's so good. All right. I was for sure, whenever Pastor Brad told me that this scripture was in the liturgical calendar for today, he asked me several weeks ago to do this, and we've been preparing for Caitlin's wedding. She got married October the 10th, and I was sure that I would use that illustration for this sermon today, and that is not what God gave me. The complete opposite of that, I would say. Let's start with prayer. Father God, we come to you with excited hearts. Some may be hurting. Some may be desperate. Some may be rejoicing. But God, we are united as the body of Christ, and may you give us the grace and the peace to lay it all aside and to devote this next 15 to 20 minutes. Father, in the whole scheme of a 7-day week and all the time that we have, let us fully devote this time to you. To search you out, to hear your voice, to feel your presence, to be seated close to you, snuggled in. Father, hide me, and that your people would only see and hear you. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. One of the hardest things that I have ever had to say in my life was in the year of 2009. Gwen was our one and only foreign exchange student. We grew to love her dearly. We did not have any children, and she was in our home for almost 10 months. We had our two little dogs, Zeke and Zoe, but no children. She was from Amsterdam, the Netherlands. Now, what you have heard about Amsterdam is what you know and what is real about Amsterdam. The faith in Amsterdam was very, very low percentage. And when I say faith, I mean any faith whatsoever. So Christianity was not a big thing there. Well, before she arrived, we had communication with her. We explained to her, there are no children in our home for you to connect with. We've got two little dogs, and we are Christians. We go to church when the doors are open. Steve and I were part of the youth program there. We were leading this group of kids, and we told her, when you come here, you will go to church when we go. And you will be a part of everything that we do there. And she agreed to go. She said, that's part of what I want to learn. I want to experience these new and different things. Well, after many times of Gwen sitting in church and intently listening to the pastor, we would come home and she would say, those stories are crazy. I just can't believe some of the things that I'm hearing. I said, well, honey, I'm telling you that when I read scripture, if it tells me it happened, I believe that it happened. I have no reason, nothing in me doubts that. So one night at our dining room table, she asked this question. Do you really believe that you have to be a Christian to go to heaven. Out of the deepest heartache, fear, as much compassion and as much boldness that God would give me, I answered her, "Yes, honey, it's exactly what I believe. I believe that you have to accept Jesus Christ as your Savior and to be a Christian to go to heaven. I believe that Jesus lived and breathed on this earth and that he taught his disciples and the people around him all that he could, that he was crucified, that he was buried, that on the third day he rose again, and that he sits at the right hand of the Father, and that he lives in us today. Yes, Gwen, I believe that you must be a Christian to go to heaven." And with a look of hurt and betrayal and some anger, she asked, "So do you believe that I'm going to go to hell?" This is reality. We live a life of accountability and responsibility to our faith, to share it with everyone around us, regardless of how hard it may be. We are living in the most uncertain times that some of us have ever known. This is the first time I've experienced such uncertainty at almost 50 years of age. Possibly some of the worst of times we may have ever experienced. And as Christians, we should be very aware. We should be prepared. Recently, I received a text from the owner of the company that Steve and I work for, and his name is Jim, and he is a deep thinker. He analyzes everything in great and sometimes even tormenting detail. Dennis or somebody, do we have a clock? I need to be able to watch my time. Or somebody just shout out and tell me how much time I got. He asked me to read an excerpt on heaven and earth. He'd sent me a text and to let him know what I thought about it. Well, in a nutshell, it referenced several scriptures about what heaven and earth would look like. The article was very intriguing. It challenged my thinking, and Jim wanted a response from me. He wanted my thoughts and my opinions. Well, I'm the complete opposite. I don't analyze anything. I'm a very simple thinker. So for me, this was a challenge, but I went straight to Scripture, straight to the living, breathing Word. I sent Jim several texts of different scriptures that I pulled out about what Scripture tells me, what heaven or the new earth and what hell may be like. Without going into any great detail or debate, John 14, verses 1 through 3, Jesus says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God and trust also in me. There is more than enough room in my Father's home. If this were not so, would I have told you that I am going to prepare a place for you? When everything is ready, I will come and get you so that you will always be with me where I am." Anna and Will, Cameron, any other kids? Cadence Kennedy, you've not heard me say this. Anna, what does it mean when Scripture tells us that I will do something? Will, do you remember? It's a promise. When God says, I will do something, not a might, not possibly, but I promise, this is what's going to happen. I will come and get you. I cannot, I will not stand here today and tell you exactly what heaven, the new earth, hell, or any other place that I have not been would look like. But I can tell you what I know, what I believe, beyond a shadow of a doubt. In John 14, verse 6, Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. Jim had no idea what scripture I would be preaching on today when he sent me that text. But this question that he posed to me set me on a track of preparation. I need to be held accountable. Miss Ann and I were talking one day after we had resumed worship together. And I told her that during this time of COVID, during this time of being cut off from the outside world, that I had become more like the world than I had in a really long time. During a time of being disconnected from the body of Christ, being disconnected from a huge place of accountability for me, during a time when I should have drawn closer to Jesus than ever before, in the midst of a pandemic, in the midst of quarantine, and life slowed down, I didn't have as many responsibilities, I grew complacent and lazy. I failed to search for God above all things. In Matthew 24, verses 45 through 51, Jesus tells a parable of a master who has someone, and we're going to call him the chef, this is the crystal version, overseeing the kitchen. The master depends on the chef to feed the workers on time every day. The master expects that he can drop in at any time of any day and find the chef doing his job. This man or woman who loves God and is working for him. But if that person does not love God and is only concerned for themselves, the moment the master is away, he does what he pleases. He abuses the help and throws parties for his friends. And the master shows up the minute that he least expects it. It will not be good. Who are you accountable to? My family holds me accountable. My kids hold me accountable. This church holds me accountable. My full-time job, Jim, Steve's my boss, holds me accountable. But my ultimate accountability should be to my Savior, Jesus Christ, the very one who literally gave everything for me. Jesus lived here on earth with us, and while he was here, he taught us. In Matthew 22, verses 35 through 40, an expert in religious law tried to discredit Jesus by asking, which is the most important commandment in the law of Moses? Jesus replied, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment, and a second is equally important. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. The entire law and all the demands of the prophets are based on these two commandments. Side note, the demands of the prophets is what Jesus taught the disciples and the prophets to teach us, for us to teach others. First, to love the Lord our God with all that we are, and second, to love each other as we love ourselves. Would you deny yourself the greatest love of all? Would you purposely distance yourself from the Father? Would you intentionally turn away an eternity in heaven in exchange for an eternity in hell? We are called. We have a responsibility to everyone around us, to anyone that we encounter, to love them as we love ourselves, and to share the love of God with them. This can look like so many different things. It can be a shoulder to cry on, to share a meal with someone who's hungry, to come alongside and pray. Jessica prayed over me before I came in here this morning. To donate to United Way or to donate to a private kid for Christmas that may not have something. This can look like so many different things. It doesn't have to involve money. There's a box of books. I've got some over here, but there's more if you want them. It's a little red and gray book, and it's a modern day tract. It's a testimony of Jesus and his love, and it's called the Book of Life. Grab as many of those as you want. I have about six more boxes in the youth room. I laughed. I'm putting this on social media, so, you know, it's not like it's a secret, but we had our church council meeting the other night. I said, you can take as many of these and put them anywhere you want because our name's not on them. Nobody's going to know that you're the one that left it there. Do we not want people to know that we left it there? That First United Methodist Church is a church that loves people, and we back it up. We don't just say it. We don't just talk about it. But that we love our neighbors as ourselves. Justin White was one of our church kids, and when I put this pack on my elastic pants today, I got tickled. I thought, I know what Justin feels like. He was in youth group and in my home for several years, and I have to say that Justin has a huge place in my heart. He always will. Justin was given a very special gift from God. He is all about rescue, fire, police. He serves our community now as a police officer. He's all grown up. But from a young high school age, Justin was part of the Monroe County Rescue Squad. He was a tall, skinny boy with a pager so heavy on his pants that he could barely keep those shorts up. But that pager was always present. It was always on him. There were several times during our youth lesson. Now, y'all probably remember this. Anna's shaking her head. Yes, she knows exactly what I'm talking about. Anna, you were beautiful last night. I haven't got to tell you that, but you were absolutely gorgeous. These babies are growing up. But that pager would go off, and Justin would fly out through the youth room, and everybody would turn around and look, see what was going on. And then it got to be kind of like, oh, Justin's got a call, you know, and he would fly out of there. But every time, and my kids can attest to this as well, every time he would head out that door, I would say, Justin, please be careful. I love you, buddy. Lord, watch over him and keep him safe, and slow down. What if we practiced such urgency? What if we wore a proverbial pager, one that was big enough to tug on our pants and get our attention with a sounding alarm? In Matthew 25, verses 1 through 13, I still have no idea what time it is. Somebody want to tell me, just stink. Don't worry about it. Okay, well, all right, Margaret, it's her fault. Matthew 25, 1 through 13, Jesus is stressing a sense of urgency in this parable. 10 bridesmaids took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 were foolish, 5 were wise. The 5 foolish failed to take enough oil for their lamps. The 5 wise took plenty of oil for their lamps. The night grew long as they waited his arrival, but he was delayed. The bridesmaids became tired, and they went to sleep. At midnight, there was a shout, "Look, the bridegroom is here. Quickly come and see." All 10 of the bridesmaids took their lamps. The 5 foolish said to the wise, "We do not have enough oil, and our lamps are going out." But the wise said, "No. We do not have enough for you and for us, so you must leave this place and go buy your own." While the 5 foolish were gone to buy their oil, the bridegroom came. Those who were prepared, those who had enough oil, entered into the wedding banquet with the bridegroom, and the door was closed behind them. Sometime later, the 5 foolish returned after the door had already been closed and the banquet had begun. The 5 foolish stood outside the door, banging on it and pleading, "Please let us in." But the bridegroom denied their entrance. His response, "You cannot come in because I do not know you." Be aware. Live in this urgency of awaiting the bridegroom. Be prepared because you do not know the day or the hour. Now, this scripture of denying someone some oil, Anne is my oil. That's an inside joke, but it's okay. If y'all want to know, I'll tell you later. Denying another one some oil may seem cruel, but the oil here represents our faith, that we believe in Jesus Christ, and it will be our confession to God on the day of judgment. We are prepared with enough oil. Let me ask you, who are you in this parable? Do you have plenty of oil? Do you have more than enough? Are you anxiously, with anticipation, awaiting the bridegroom? Or do you have barely enough? Are you delaying the commitment? And if you are, what are you waiting on? Are you afraid of giving up what seems so good in this world? What you're holding on so tightly to that makes Jesus take a back seat? Just like we sang, like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church ready for you, that our hearts are longing for our King. So Jesus, come. We should be deeply concerned for other people's faith, doing our part in sharing the gospel, the love of Christ. People are dying every day. One of the worst things that I've ever had to do was trying to console a mother whose son had passed away, and there was no proof that he was a Christian. None whatsoever. Think about that. Where does your hope come from? Who do you have faith in? Because the day will come of judgment. And how are you going to feel if you do not know that the people that you have encountered, that you have not given the opportunity to experience the greatest love of all? Do you want to miss out on that? Back to Gwen. She returned home to Amsterdam. She'd been back for a few months, and I received an email from her stepfather, and there was a video attached to this email. And I tried to find that video. It's engraved in my mind, will be forever. I wanted to show it to you today, but I couldn't find it. The family had gone out to eat in a restaurant in Amsterdam, and they were seated at a table in a public place. And as she fumbled through and giggled in between, Gwen asked her family to bow their heads and to say a prayer of blessing over their food in the name of Jesus Christ. I would love to tell you today that Gwen is a Christian, but I cannot. Listen to me. If you don't hear anything I've said today, we are called. We are disciples. It is not just my job. It is not just Pastor Brad's job. It is not just Miss Jacqueline's job. It is our responsibility as Christians to share the love of God and to plant a seed in anyone that we have the ability to have contact with. Now, let me release the burden from you. Steve and I went to a conference at the Cove in North Carolina, and one of the best things I ever heard was that speaker, I think it was Andy McDowell or McDonald, or anyway, he's a renowned author. He said, "It is not your responsibility to get them saved." Do you understand me? The saving part is between them and their Savior, Jesus Christ. You cannot make someone accept Jesus Christ, but you can share the love of Jesus. You can share what He is to you and the hope that you have, that you know the day the bridegroom comes, the hope that we have. The firm foundation that we have is in being fully in the presence of Jesus Christ. As much as I love my family, as much as I love my kids, my church, Gwen, all of those that I've had the honor of sharing the love of Christ with, my oil, my faith will only sustain me. And will only account for me when the bridegroom comes. When the bridegroom arrives, my oil is what I'll represent to the Father. Just mine. My desire is that we would be a church ready for her groom. That we would be a church longing for our King. Let us pray. Father, we long to be. Father, I long for our church to be like a bride waiting for her groom. That we would be a church ready for you. That we would be a people who would not keep the greatest love of all to ourselves. That we would have the boldness to stand before you on the day of judgment, the day that you show up, that our lamps will be full. And that no one that we have had the honor of being in the presence of will have to come to us and say, "Can I please have some oil? And we will not be ripped apart by having to say, no, I cannot give you any. I wish I would have told you 5 years ago that you needed to be ready for this day. I wish I would have told you today or yesterday that you need to be prepared. I don't want to have to do that. I don't want to have to deny anyone anything to keep them from the presence and the love of my Savior, Jesus Christ. In his name I pray. Amen. The altar is open. If you want to come up and pray, you're more than welcome to. If you want me or anyone else to pray with you, the altar is for you.
Holy, 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 holy.
May you leave this place today in a sense of urgency to be about the Father's business. That you would wear that proverbial pager that tugs on your pants and makes you aware of what you are called to do. That you may be the one that might change someone's eternity. That you would be so filled with the power of the Holy Spirit and with the presence of your Father, your Savior Jesus Christ, that you would want to share the greatest love of all with everyone that you have contact with. Now go in the name of the Son and of the Father and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.